My name is Mike Lennon. I'm a retired New York City fireman. The few years that I've been retired, I followed my passion for writing and filmmaking. On September 11th, shortly after the second tower fell, I, like many other retired city firemen, dashed into Lower Manhattan to see what we could do. It was there that I spent the better part of 2 weeks digging through the rubble and the iron and the metal, trying to find my brothers. After the second week, my wife finally talked me into grabbing my camera, and instead of digging, to start filming. I filmed over 40 firehouses that men had been lost in, and I was able to document what was going through the minds of those firemen who were on duty, firemen who had been down there when the towers fell and survived, and now they're on duty a few weeks later. These men were in agony. They were very, very tortured about what had happened, yet they're working, and if the bell goes off, they're on the truck ready to catch the run-in. It's a nobility that's hard to believe. It's almost like out of a storybook, but it's true. I saw this with my own eyes. I had the privilege of meeting John Santor over in Ladder 5 in the West Village. I interviewed him a few times, and for some reason, the project wound up on hold. I became very fond of John, and I had looked forward to shooting him some more. On September 11th, John Santor passed away, along with a number of other members of his firehouse. And he was a special guy. He was one of 343 special guys, honorable guys, guys that need to have a story told about them.
John Santor, been on the fire department for 19 years. Been at this house for 19 years. I got assigned here. And sort of like made it my second home, away from home.
The morning of September 11th, he was sitting at the kitchen table covering Tiana's books for school. He always put the brown paper on the books. He was starting at 24 that morning, Tuesday till Wednesday. And I know he went upstairs to see her because he told me, she told me that she was in the bathroom taking a shower and he knocked on the door. Tiana, just stick your head out. I just want to give you a kiss.
I mean, we're regular people. We do regular things on the outside. Just that, you know, when it comes to fighting fires, we do it till, you know, you have to do something that you know that you might get killed at, but you do it because that's what people expect and that's, you know, what we do.
Yeah, go ahead, Matt.
All right, you're going to get engine 258-259-325-262.
We had a battalion call on the air regarding a plane hitting the towers in Ladder 10 on the voice alarm. Most of it stated the same thing. And at the same time, the ERS box came in for 8087. So we had three different sources coming in at one time. We started rolling companies over the voice alarm. We took everybody from 125th Street on down, just told them to take everything that you have and start responding.
We said, all right, this is going to be bad, but we didn't know how bad it was going to be.
This came in at 8:46, whatever it is. That's right in the middle of the change of tours. There were guys sitting there dressed, probably ready to go home. If you were to fire around the corner, guys will jump on a truck and go around the corner. This, there was no way guys weren't going to go. They just knew that this was a massive effort it was going to take.
I stood up, and all of a sudden, all these people that were near the window came running toward me. I went back up to our floor, the 23rd floor of 7 World Trade, ran around the floor, made sure that our emergency operations center was getting up and running, that our communications was operating properly, and grabbed my portable radios and left the office. And it was the last time I'd ever see my office.
If those buildings hadn't come down, they were firemen were going to die there that day. There was no ifs, ands, or buts about it. And when Walter, his company was sent to respond after the second plane hit, and before he left the firehouse, he called his wife, and he told her, Second plane just hit. It doesn't look good. I love you. I love the kids. Tell my mother I love her. And he hung up.
We had a bad feeling when we left the firehouse. Me, Jimmy, and the lieutenant said the same thing. We got a bad feeling. And it just felt kind of funny. Like, it's just not right, you know? Because normally you go to a fire, you drive, you get there, and you see the fire. We're a mile away, and we can see the fire rate. So you already know what you're getting, what you got.
Right, I'm saying to myself, I wonder if my son took that running. I assume he did, but I didn't know. As I'm watching the fire, I see the plane come into the second tower. And the explosion, the flame, and then the realization that it was terrorism. I decided I was going to walk over the Brooklyn Bridge to the fire.
It was a covering boss from 205, Bobby Wallace. He had scheduled Brian McAleese to drive. So I pulled Brian aside, asked him if he minded if I drove, because I wasn't feeling so hot. And nobody wants to drive. Nobody wants to be the chauffeur. So he gladly said, go ahead, you could drive.
And companies started arriving. One of the companies that came in told us that there was already a dead fireman outside on Liberty Street, and that a jumper had landed on top of him, a guy from 216 engine. So we already knew. I mean, the gravity of this was really starting to sink in.
You know, I knew the alarm assignments. I knew my company was there. I knew Brian's company was there. I knew everybody that was there, you know. So, you know, I'm saying immediately, what am I going to do? I got to get somebody for the baby, and I got to go in, you know. This was before they had the recall.
As we were going out the door, Brian, who was senior to me, asked me if I was sure I didn't want to get on the back step and let him drive. And not because he was scared or he didn't want to, you know, go up there, just because he wanted me as a younger guy to get the experience. So I have a lot of guilt about that he was supposed to be driving originally, and I kind of asked him if I could drive. And then even to that last minute, as we're going out the door, he asked me if he could drive, just for my sake, not for anything against him. But at that point, no fireman is going to say, yeah, you drive now, because I made my bed, now I got to lie in it.
She said, she's talking about, she can hear everybody in the background screaming and crying and yelling for help. And the only thing she could tell them to do is to stay where they were. You know, fire department will try to get to you. This is the normal procedure we do.
Chinatown's ladder company 6 arrived at the North Tower about to begin a very long day.
So I'm talking to myself, saying, okay, the elevators are out, you don't have to walk to 80. You know, you need to suck it up. There's people up there that need help. You know, we have to get there as quickly as possible. And that's when the South Tower got hit with the second plane, because you could hear the plane. You could see the shadow come across the street. And I was looking out the window, and you could hear the explosion. And then from the World Financial Center across the street, the windows are very shiny, like a mirror. And you could see the flame, the fireball above us.
Down, I went to the courtyard because I wanted to get a view of, like a good fireman would, get a view of three sides of the building to try and get a size up of what it looks like. And as I got up to the courtyard, basically the courtyard was all on fire. There was debris. There were plane parts, there were body parts, there was a lot of stuff still coming down. Big stuff, not something small, but big, heavy steel and things like that. I went by the elevators in the core of number 1 World Trade, and there were a lot of firemen there waiting to go up the stairs. There was a chief giving them instructions on what to do.
And if you didn't know you were going into a big time hurt, you were a fool. You were either a fool or you didn't know the job. You know, that was something no firefighter in this world had ever seen.
And so I remember seeing Terry look over all the other firemen and seeing me and just giving me a nod, like, come over here. So I went over to see Terry, and he looked down at me and he gave me a big hug. He had a special Halligan, a short Halligan, and he put his arms around me and gave me a big hug and said, I love you, brother. Might be the last time I see you. And we hugged for a minute. I kissed him on the cheek, and he went into the stairwell to do his job. That was the last time I saw him.
At this point, I looked up, and I think anywhere in Manhattan, when you look up, you could see the towers anywhere around there, but they were just directly over our head, and I just remember thinking that this is bad. So I grabbed Stan, and I just, you know, I grabbed him by the shoulder, and I said, Stan, be careful, this is bad. Same thing with Dave, and then the same thing with Brian, and they were all like, you know, we're going to be all right, we're going to do our thing, and they just marched off. And that was the last I saw them.
On our way up, the civilians were giving us encouragement, you know, crying. A lot of people crying. Some were okay. Some were burnt. And we had to step to the side and let them through.
By the time we got to the 13th floor, there was a woman passing out. Someone handed us a resuscitator. We started giving her oxygen. My boss said, I'm going up to somebody said something for 17. He went up to 17. So me and one of the other firemen stayed at 13 with this woman. And we were giving her oxygen. Next thing you know, someone came down and said, a civilian said that someone's having a heart attack on 16. So I told the guy I was with, I'll go up, I'll check it out, I'll be right down. I walked up to 16, and there was a guy there, a heavy man. He looked pretty bad. He was having problems breathing. I said, are you all right? You think you're having a heart attack? He goes, I don't know. So I said, I'll be right back. I went up one more floor to 17, told my lieutenant what was happening. I said, I'm going to take this guy down to 13 where the air is and give him air.
And there I was, just in the street, hooked up. I didn't know. There was no one to tell me what I should have done. Should I stretch a line, feed a standpipe? Do I go in? Do I stay? And I mean, I second-guessed myself today about that.
We still hadn't gotten word back yet that we had jet fighters up above us to protect us. And over my OEM radio, we heard that there was a third plane incoming. And I spread that word around for everybody to try and protect themselves as much as they could, because we might be getting hit by another plane. I mean, it was just complete chaos. We were at war at that point, you know?
You know, I suited up, I put all my gear on. And at one point, I actually started to make my way towards the towers, and I said, I can't leave the rig. And it was just, I was totally torn on what I should have been doing.
And it was a huge, tremendous rumble and a roar, and the building shook, and all the lights went out. It went completely pitch black. And then the lights came back on, and slowly the lights came back on.
When the building stopped shaking, I went back inside. The guy was sitting there, he was fine. Next thing you know, you're hearing all Maydays in the hallway on the radios. And a Port Authority cop said to me, was coming down, he says they want to evacuate the building. People started walking back up too. I started chasing them back down. I said, you gotta leave.
And I personally thought there were bombs being placed throughout the building that went off. Mike thought something else. Tommy thought it was, you know, jet fuel igniting. They thought it was another plane. We didn't think that the South Tower had collapsed. We had no reason to think that.
At that point, I heard what I thought was the third plane coming. But when I turned around to look, it wasn't the third plane. It was the tower, the top of the tower coming down. And I just remember it looked like you see the video of the skiers with the avalanche coming after them. That's what it looked like. And I just basically, I just ran. And I made it, I'd say, maybe 30 feet. And I jumped under an ESU truck.
So we're running along the side of number two, staying tight to the building so we didn't get crushed by anything that was coming down. All of a sudden, you could hear the roar up above your head. And there was no question that it was the building collapsing. And so I turned and ran, and I told him to follow me. And we stayed along the building, and we ducked into the lobby of the Marriott Hotel. Just as we got in the hotel, it was clear as a bell. And as fast as it was clear, it went pitch black. And you could see the dust cloud just overtook us. The wind picked up to like 30, 35 miles an hour. Just started blowing everything at us. So I turned around, but I couldn't go back outside, and now I was trapped. And I got on my hands and knees and found a column, a boxed out steel column, and I just grabbed onto it and held on. And the wind just picked up tremendous. It was about, I have to say, somewhere between 75 and 100 miles an hour. And my feet were up in the air. I was trying to hold on to the column. And I thought I was dead. So I'm sure that everybody that was anywhere near there thought they were dead.
The collapse took 10 seconds. And down came 96,000 tons of steel, along with pulverized concrete, glass, desks, file cabinets, computers, carpets, and human beings. Among the many human beings were hundreds of men from the Fire Department of New York. Several of them, carrying 60 pounds of equipment, had made it all the way to the 78th floor.
And that's when the Mayday comes in. Mayday, Mayday, Mayday. Everybody out of the building. 30 and below out of the building. So, and I remember that distinctively because I remember talking to myself again saying, what about 31 and above? Because Patty Brown and Ladder 3 were above us. There were a lot of companies above us.
The radio contact was horrible. You weren't hearing nothing. Like when I watched the tape about it, I've seen, they were calling to get guys out. I never heard anybody trying to get us out. There was guys with radios near me, passing by, I never heard nothing. You could hear radios, guys above us. There was guys floors above us in the hall, and I could hear some of the radio, some of the talking.
Josephine is a civilian employee of the Port Authority. She's a grandmother who lives in Brooklyn, African-American, 55 years old, little heavy set, normal, typical 55-year-old woman with bad feet. She had falling arches in her feet. So she was walking very slow, and she had been coming down from the 71st floor. So we run into her around 15. She's already gone a long way, and she's tired. She was walking very slowly, and it wasn't a quick, you know, it was one step, 2 feet on each step, one, and Tommy and Billy talking to her. And me and Mike looking back saying, you know, let's go now.
At this point, I kind of knew that my guys were inside. I was hoping that they weren't. I just really didn't even think about it. I just said, all right, we got to go in and we got to try to get somebody out of there. And I was hoping that it was going to be my guys. But I really wasn't thinking about that. I was just thinking that, I don't know if I just put it all out of my head or I don't know what I did.
I'm on 11 now. Now I'm on 10. Now I'm on 9. Let's go. I want to get out of here now, you know? And we made it down to the fourth floor, landing inside the stairwell, and that's when she stops. You can't get her to move anymore. She's, I'm done, leave me alone. I'm tired, I don't want to go anymore, stop pushing me. And so now they're talking to her, Josephine, you want to see your grandchildren, you want to see, you know, your children, let's go. I'm tired, leave me alone. And about 30 seconds after that, a minute after that, and we still stayed together, but then you could hear the tower crumbling from the top down. You could hear huge explosions, you know, boom, boom. And as the floors came down, it got quicker. So you hear these huge, tremendous explosions, and the wind started kicking up, and the building started to rumble, and you could hear boom, 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 and then it all came down.
The North Tower fell at 10:29, live on television, again. In 10 brutal seconds. All over New York, people knew members of their families were in those towers. Friends were in those towers. Firemen were in those towers.
Us being on the fourth floor, we were getting pummeled with debris and sheetrock and concrete, but it had stopped at the sixth floor. So above that was the sky. And that the sixth floor landing was just twisted and destroyed. Above that was sky, where a 110-story building once stood was nothing.
It came down. I had my mask this time, so I breathed through the whole thing, and I thought I was dead. I said, all right, I lived through the first one, but now I'm going to get it this time. And I just waited for, I thought someone was going to fall on me.
And then when the second tower went down, then I screamed, because then I knew. Then I worried for my husband more, because then I knew that this doesn't make sense. How do these two towers go down, you know?
I've known Pat for years, and he was in Rescue 1, he was a captain, and a legendary guy, and beyond brave, like a superhero. And I think I knew, and I even turned to my girlfriend when the building fell down. I turned to her and I said, I know Pat Brown just died.
The down part is like when you saw those buildings come down. As far as a firefighter, I felt like a total failure because I had never felt such total despair, and I never felt such total helplessness. I had said there's nobody left alive. The quietness on the radio was stabbing.
Just the dead silence on the air was extremely scary and really nervous. It was something you don't forget. I mean, you hear everybody screaming and yelling, the tower's coming down, but when there's nobody out there to talk to, and in a fire department, that's unusual, because usually When we call somebody, we get an answer no matter who they are.
About half an hour into it, 20 minutes into it, Captain Jonas gave our mayday, because prior to that, other companies were giving maydays, but we were quiet. We didn't give a mayday, and we didn't answer any maydays either, because we were in no position to help anybody. We sat tight. We tried to make Josephine as comfortable as we could. We checked her out. She was okay.
And then I spent the next 10, 15 hours walking around the whole site, asking for my son, looking for my son, helping wherever I could.
I had a pretty bad concussion, and they brought me to the hospital. And there was a priest in there, and he was, like, praying with me. And I was just, I was hysterical. I was so out of it. You know, I knew the guys were in there. And they were making me stay for tests or whatever. They were washing my eyes out. And I walked out and I walked back down there.
And I found the rig. It was parked on the other side over by the American Express building. There was no damage to the rig. And saw the riding list. His name, of course, wasn't on it because he had been relieved. But I found a chauffeur who was in a daze, and he told me that Michael had gotten on the rig, and in fact, he had taken his mask when they got to the building.
So our standard procedure is you let somebody know when your company is missing. I told him, I said, Chief, 226, my guys are in there. And he said, Tommy, everybody's guys are in there. And we just lost, which thank God it was a high estimate. He said 10,000 civilians and 500 firemen. And I just kind of like started walking away.
We go over to the command post and we'd ask the chief, I'm from 15 engine, we've lost our officer and several of the firemen. You know, I couldn't get, what was disheartening is I couldn't get one fire chief to look me in the eye and say, well, they're okay, or we think they'd all turn away, because I think they knew that, you know, there were many, many, many guys, you know, lost.
We got out of there around 2:30 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So the building had come down at 10:30. We got out of there around 2:33, so it's anywhere between four and a half hours. Believe it, I didn't believe what I was saying. You know, and then I wanted to jump up and down and tell everybody that I'm alive. And I was there, and I survived. Could you believe I survived it? But I didn't say a word, because I'm saying, I'm looking around, and everybody's crying, and guys are messed up, and guys are hurt. And I'm saying, wow, there's nothing to be happy about here. You know, there was a lot of guilt. I said, wow, how? Then it went from being happy I survived it. In the split second, I said, well, why me that survived it?
It was around 10 o'clock, 8 o'clock at night, 9:30 at night, and I walked. I was just in a daze. I walked to the firehouse, and I walked in. Everyone just couldn't do enough for me. I just went down to his locker and seen he was there. Took some personal stuff, and his car keys of his girlfriend, the car was outside, and I just wanted to drive home. I had called my wife, and she said, telling me, no, Michael was okay. And I said, Barbara, no, Michael's not okay. He's missing, and we just pray. But I didn't think at any point after 10 o'clock at night that they were going to find him.
As a firefighter, you're never supposed to give up. And I sort of did. I said, there's nobody left. There's nobody left alive. I also, going home that night, I thought on a ferry, I couldn't look back at the city. And I thought I saw 50,000 people die, because I covered around there. And we used to say, I forget how many people a tower.
And I just walked, I walked back to Brooklyn. I walked over to Brooklyn Bridge. I walked through the streets of Brooklyn, and I walked to State Street, and I made that left. And I just walked right to the firehouse, and I walked to the firehouse, and I said, I'm walking, and I'm getting on a plane, and I'm leaving. I'm not staying here. I can't do it anymore. I can't ever feel the way I felt, knowing that the guys I drove to a fire were gone. I still don't know if I want to do it.
The search for survivors began. Nobody yet knew that almost 3,000 people were dead in the greatest calamity in New York history. Nobody yet knew that many had been smashed into dust, Many had simply evaporated. The remains of too many emerged as mere fragments.
You got there and there was literally nothing but paper, dust, steel, that's it, nothing. There was no indication that anything had ever been in those buildings. Nothing. I mean, you didn't come across a computer, a file cabinet, a desk. There had to be thousands of bathrooms, nothing. It was the nothingness just struck me that this isn't good. I mean,
all you wanted to do was get in there and start digging. But as you know, we dug for days and we found no one. It's a tough feeling. Being a fireman, you want to help. You train to pull people out. You expect to pull people out, especially with something like that. There were so many people in there, and there was no one. It was tough mentally to deal with that.
I found the wheel of a chair. I was like, wow, a wheel of a chair. You know, I found something whole. You know, everything was so pulverized that it was just pretty depressing, you know?
It became apparent to me within the first couple of hours that, you know, there's nobody alive here. It was just too catastrophic, you know, it was just too big. You couldn't make out what you were looking at because everything was covered in that gray dust.
Probably the worst thing I ever saw in my life. We never in a million years thought we were going to end up where we did. And what we saw, the devastation that we saw was just unbelievable. It just couldn't, you'd never be able to explain it to anybody. It was just terrible.
The dead included 343 firemen. This was the single worst one-day loss in the department's history. It created 244 widows. More than 606 children of firefighters lost a parent.
Well, they haven't found Brian, which doesn't help. I had said from the very beginning, I was not applying for a death certificate, and I was not going to have any kind of service until they brought him home. He deserves that. He deserves the proper burial, the proper honorable funeral that they get. And I just wasn't going to do it.
They found him on Friday night, and they told me, Fran, they found John. They found John, you know. And I said, and? And they said, you know, he's gone.
I went back down to the site after they located his remains, and I was taken down to where they found him, which was right at the entrance to the building, which meant they just missed getting out by seconds or a minute, the whole company. But when I went down there to say a prayer, the respect shown me by the people, the construction workers, and the firefighters and the policemen. You know, everyone stopped and they let me say a prayer and they formed a circle around me. So I remember that. I'll always remember that.
I mean, Brian left that morning, told us he loved us, told us he'd see us later. I'll see you tonight, love yous. Like he did, I don't know how many times. I don't know how many times. And he just never came home. And they have never found him. So it's, you know, it's like a child being taken in the night. You don't know.
And that there is nothing, no recovery. It's amazing, you know. And it doesn't help when the medical examiner tells you, well, we have 22,000 body parts. To you, it's a body part. To me, it's my child.
Well, sometimes we see bodies being taken out and they draped in flags and all the uniform members standing, saluting, you know, watching the body come out. That's like a heart-wrenching thing to see that happen, you know. But in the meanwhile, it gives the family a little closure, you know, because a lot of families are not going to find anything here, you know. So the few who do, really, you know, it's great for them, you know. Every little bit helps for them, you know.
Chief Pfeiffer, his brother was killed. And while I was down there, we found his brother. And he was working. He came down and was there when we were taking him out, got his time to kneel with his brother, and then helped carry his brother out. And I think that was probably the most uplifting thing I ever saw, to see this. And you could tell through his grief how proud he was of his brother. And
It's an amazing thing. I think the pride can almost overwhelm the grief.
We lost 14 men between the two companies. One of the guys was actually in here on vacation, wasn't even supposed to be working. Happened at the change of tours, so some guys that were supposed to go home went on the rig, and job-wide, there's close to about 100 guys that didn't need to be there. They weren't working. They were just looking to be there to help.
There isn't a firehouse in the city wasn't directly affected. I worked with, personally, in my career, at least 20 of those guys that were dead, and I knew 50.
But, I mean, since day one, probably even up to now, just the constant procession of faces of guys you used to know who are no longer with us.
People realize that. You may not have been working with them at the time, but 343 guys you worked with, you knew or worked with some of them somewhere along your career, you know, or were related to them.
The sad part for us on Staten Island now, personally in our battalion, is that out of all the guys that left Staten Island, we only got one guy back.
When you hear the signal 5555, this is an announcement of the death of a firefighter.
I'm on the job 13 and a half years now. And since then, I believe it was 22 people were killed in the line of duty. And you would hear four fives maybe once a year, a couple times a year.
After the 11th, you heard these 20, 30 times a day when they found a confirmed body of a deceased firefighter.
The whole firehouse just stops. Anything you're doing, everyone drops it and just listens. Maybe you'll know the name that they're going to call out. And it'll just, until everyone's found or everyone's declared dead, every time that you hear that in the firehouse, everything will continue to stop.
One of these guys from this Jersey department, he's in the house watch, and I walk in and he says, "Do you work here?" And I said, "Yeah, what's the problem?" He says, "You gotta take over this phone here." He says, "I can't do this anymore." And I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "I've been answering this phone all night," and he goes, "Every phone call is a wife or a girlfriend, and they're asking me, is so-and-so okay? And he goes, "I don't know what to tell him." So I said, "All right." I says, "Go get a cup of coffee." I said, "I'll sit out here for a while."
You see, you go up into the locker room, you see all the lockers, you know, of the brothers that had died that day. You walk outside the quarters, you open the apparatus door, you see cars that they had driven to work. You actually come to the reality that, you know, that could have been me. I could have been working that tour. That could have been my car. That could be my locker that has to eventually be emptied out and all the belongings given back to my loved ones.
And then the memorials, we were going to 2, 3, 4 memorials a day. You know, and every single one we went to was a memorial because nobody was recovered. You know, and it was, I spent, you know, the next 2 months going to memorials. And then my brother's memorial was December 7th. We had that on Friday, Pearl Harbor Day.
But in the ensuing weeks after it happened, I had gone to a lot of funerals myself and wakes. And I was amazed at the amount of firefighters from around the country that flew into New York for these wakes and funerals.
It's like you're with all of these firemen, and it was like they're from Canada. Guys drove from Iowa. Came here on Sunday, drove from Iowa, went to the wake for an hour, came back, and drove back to Iowa. Guys from New Orleans, Vancouver, British Columbia, Chicago, Illinois, everywhere. Unbelievable.
And then you wonder, you know, where were they? Was he scared? You know, what was he thinking of? You know, did he look up and see it coming? You know, was he trapped? Was he suffering? Was it fast? That's all you think about.
I met one guy from the Hicksville Volunteer Fire Department who's also a city fireman who said he saw Brian before the whole thing. He saw Brian as they were all coming in. And I said to him, did Brian look scared or, you know? And he said, absolutely not. He said Brian had his captain's face on and he was ready to go to work, you know? And that's all I have. That's it. Out of this whole thing. Which I guess should be enough, you know? Has to be enough.
I tried to find out, did they know what floor they were on, or when did they see them last? And they said that they saw them last on the 37th floor, and the engine was going down stairwell A, and the ladder was going down stairwell C. But the engine got down and got out on stairwell A, but stairwell C must have been blocked at some point, or maybe there was just too many people, or maybe there was more injured people. You know, I know that they said that a few people were in wheelchairs, and I know they weren't going to leave anybody in a wheelchair. And my husband would have never, he would have sat there and died with that person. He would have never left a wheelchair. Never. Never.
And again, I'm going to use that word bittersweet, because as proud as we are, he's going down in history. He's becoming part of the history books, and he deserves that. And I know in my heart he deserves that, but I have to turn around then and I have to deal with our four children and their pain and their misery. And, you know, it really doesn't matter what people try to do. It's just not going to be enough. And I don't mean that in a negative sense. You know, it's just nobody can help us. And it's just a fact. It's just a fact.
At the same time, during this time of searching and grieving, the families of the dead groped for ways to deal with loss. Some did this in public ways, others settled for a stoic privacy.
Brian and Dawn had, they have four kids under the age of five. I had to tell Dawn that I switched with Brian. And she was really supportive. You know, she understood how we work, and she knows guys are switching at the last minute, whether it be a tour or a position or, you know, who's going to do the stakes. She was great. And that was a big concern of mine, too. I wouldn't know how to handle it if she had been, you know, angry towards me.
Anybody affected by this, your life has been changed forever. And it doesn't matter how much you want to get back to normal or you don't, there's never any normalcy. And this doesn't go away.
And I say that all the time. I say, thank God I'm going through this and I'm on this job and I'm not in the private sector, because I really think the people in the private sector, the civilian families, they don't have the support that we have. And a lot of them are angry. They think that, oh, you fought them and they have, you know, you have the... We don't have the support from the city. We don't have the support from the fire department. We have the support through ourselves, through our firehouses, through our camaraderie, through our friendships, you know? This is the support we have. And people don't really get that unless they're on this job.
That was probably one of the hardest things I ever had to do, was to drive up to the house with the whole family there. And here I am, you know, the lucky one. You know, and I say lucky, I don't feel lucky, but that was pretty tough.
It's the guilt of sending everybody down there. I mean, the actions of what we did that morning, of going above what we're supposed to be doing. You know, sending everybody down who's there.
The amazing part is people don't even know that these guys were told to evacuate. Some of them heard it on the radio, some of them didn't. But you know, that part, like people have said to me, well, how do you feel about that? That part doesn't even come into play for me because of the simple fact that I know Brian. And if there were civilians in that building, he would never have come out anyway. So it doesn't matter that the radios worked or didn't work or were working and was knocked out with the plane crash or, you know, he would never, never have gotten out of that building if there was a civilian left.
That was my main thing, is I just had people tell me it's survivor's guilt and it's normal, but I was really, really beating myself up to the point where it was hurting me. You know, I've kind of gotten a little better. You know, I've told the story probably 1,000 times to different firemen, and it helped to talk about it, but I never, ever said, like, I was lucky to be alive. I never said, like, you know, thank God I was driving that day. It took me 6 months. And then when I said it, it was kind of like, it kind of took the breath out of me. I felt guilty for saying it. But then when I think about it, I mean, you know, not that anyone's life is worth more than anyone else's, but when I said that, then I knew that I had a severe problem with just being all right with the fact that I was here and those guys are gone. I felt guilty for saying it.
I said, Tommy, I don't see it that way. I said, I'm glad you're alive. I said, Tommy, I'm glad you're alive. I don't say that, geez, I wish Tommy never switched with my brother. Why is my brother dead and Tommy's not? Because I understand, I'm on this job long enough to understand that you go to any firehouse in any of the boroughs right now and you look at the riding list and you question each guy on that riding list, and I guarantee you this guy's working for this guy and this guy relieved this guy early and this guy's riding for this guy. And that's the way our job is, and that's one of the reasons why it's such a good job, because we have that flexibility.
It doesn't affect, I think New York City's sort of the mecca for firemen, I mean, if throughout the country. And in looking at the response that we got, you truly realize what a brotherhood it is. That these guys in California and Michigan and wherever they're, Alaska, wherever they came from, other countries probably, they felt what we felt. And people don't realize that because they know what we go through.
One of the many legacies of the firemen of September 11th was the way death caused one to look back and assess the meaning of life itself. Due to the limited success of the recovery mission, the families of those firemen agonized over a drama that had no script.
And I sit back now and I'm like, he prepared me for this. We did a lot of talking. You know, and I told him, oh, Brian, I could never handle this if it was you. I could never handle this. I couldn't do this. And he'd say, you could, and you will if you have to, you know. And he said he wouldn't want to die of cancer like his brother. He wouldn't want to get run over by a drunk driver. He wouldn't want to live to see anything happen to his kids. He said, if I'm going to go, I hope I go like that, as a hero in a fire. And 9 weeks later, he did.
They rescued, like, well, I think, 50,000 people or 53,000 people got out, and all of all the neighboring buildings. So, like, you know, you talk about, and it was a catastrophe, and it was horrible how many people died, but the courage of these guys, they saved thousands and thousands of people.
And there were a lot of injured people coming down now, burned and bloody and broken, and one of the stories I've wanted to tell from the start was that we knew the firemen and the policemen and the emergency workers were heroes, but there were a lot of heroes that were just normal Americans, where they helped people out that needed help. And that's America, and that's humanity, even more.
Saying calling us heroes, I didn't feel like a hero. I didn't pull anyone out. I found dead bodies, and only a couple of them.
His job was basically to save lives. That's why he became a fireman. He didn't become a fireman for the pay. I mean, the guy's got a nice gig, but he didn't do it for that. He did it because he felt he was going to help other people. So you should know that, you know, he died doing what he loved and what he was put on this earth to do. And
it's not a matter of discipline. It's not a matter of being out of not being where you're supposed to be. That's what we do. And I don't think the public realizes that. That's what we do. That's why if you're passing a house that's burning and you're walking by in your clothes, you'll run in and everybody else is running out, you'll do it anyway. And you'll go as far as you can because that's what you do. You can't not say that's not my job. That is your job. And we're on duty 24 hours a day. And just because, and none of these guys would have been looking to get paid had they all lived. It was just a matter of that's what they did. They would have spent the day there and walked home. And that would have been the end of it. Unfortunately, it didn't turn out like that.
It was a passion. It was a calling. It wasn't a job. In 20 years, I never heard the man say, I don't want to go to work. Oh, I got to go to work. Never. Sorry, babe. Got to go. See ya. You know? I mean, loved it. Loved it. And that, you know, that's a good life.
And I just reinforces what I said before, how just what a fraternity we are, magnificent and bravest, and now the world sees it, and I know the world will appreciate it when they see a firefighter going through a fire, run a rig, going to work, whatever he's doing, what she's doing, that they recognize that this person is your first line of defense in the 21st century.
And to this day, if people talk about you know, not doing this or not doing that, if you live in fear or you let it beat you, they win. And they're not going to win. You know, I mean, at least not with the firemen. They're not going to win, you know. And if that happened tomorrow, you'd have the same amount of guys running there tomorrow. It would be the same scenario. I often say the only thing my brother-in-law would have done different, I think, if he knew that building was coming down, is he probably would have said to his guys, wait here, because he's responsible for them, or he felt responsible. But that wouldn't have changed, and they wouldn't have waited there. They would have went with them anyway. That's the way we are, and that's the way we'll always be, hopefully. You know, it's very unique individuals I work with, thank God.
Never thought it would be to this magnitude. You know, they tell you, you lose a guy in your house, it takes a year or so to get back, you know, back to kind of normal, whatever you want to call it. With this type of loss, who knows? You know, the ghost will never go away, that's for sure. But, you know, we just keep kind of plugging along.
The guys up in heaven right now, they don't want us to mope around and hang our heads down. They don't want us to be defeated. They want us to go on and keep on smiling, keep on, you know, doing the things that we have done in the past. And we're going to see him again.
Yeah, it changes your perspective on life. You look at things differently. But as far as the job, we still just do our job the same way. The alarm goes off, you get on a rig and you go there. You don't know what you're going to. You know, you do your job when you get there.
You think we need more celery, or?
How much is it? A little bit. No, I wouldn't go too crazy.
Yeah, right.
What are you making?
Chicken salad. With, you know, a little celery, scallions, couple of bacon strips, lettuce, tomato. Typical firehouse lunch, you know.
A healthy firehouse.
Yeah, you know. Anything that can clog the arteries.
That's it.
All right, gentlemen, we'll catch you in a little bit.
Just as a soldier would never leave his company or platoon or partner, just as a police officer would never leave his partner, a fireman will never leave without his fellow fireman. I would never be able to face myself if I abandoned my company or my partner. And that's, every New York City fireman feels that way.
All tried to understand what had happened, why one man died and another lived. The role of chance and luck. They were comforted by the widespread recognition that the men who died that terrible morning were part of an occupation that was about saving human life. Every citizen now knew the truth of their valor and their sacrifice. One sign of gratitude was seen at many firehouses left behind by citizens. "You ran in," the sign said, "while we ran out." Of course, that was the job. That was the engine of the gallant lives they led. Their brothers and sisters will still be working to that difficult code long after the sorrow and anger of September 11th, 2001 have faded into memory.
Well, I was always pretty patriotic. I'm a former Marine, and I fought in Desert Storm. Do I think America is perfect? No. But would I want to live anywhere else? No. It's a shame that something like this has to happen for everyone to fly their flags. I'm proud to be an American, and I'm proud to be a fireman. But I'm also really sad to be a fireman right now. I had somebody come up to me one time at a benefit, and, you know, just with all the attention that the fire department is getting, which I know not one fireman wants. I know I don't want it. None of the guys in my house want it. And it was a civilian, and he said, you know, wow, it's, you know, it's a great time to be a fireman now. And I said, it's a horrible time to be a fireman. You know, you could take all this and take everything that's been given to us, all the accolades, all the press, and I don't think I know one fireman that would ever want any of it. Just give us one guy back. And that's times 343 guys.
On Raglan Road, on an autumn day, I saw her first and knew that her dark hair would weave a snare that I might one day rue. I saw the danger, yet I walked along the enchanted way. And I said, let grief be a falling leaf.